Friends, welcome to the session on Managing Global Compliance in Exports. I'm Dr. Tamanna Chaturvedi, faculty at IAFT, welcoming you for this particular course on a very interesting topic and a very pertinent topic. This session will basically tell the participants about how do you minimize your risk of export rejections when you target a particular market. For example, you're targeting an African country, you may target an Australian company, you may target a US company. Now, the regulations of one country is different than the regulations of the other country. And these regulations are very, very different in terms of four parameters. There are ethical standards, there are quality standards, there are social standards, there are technical standards, there are environmental standards. So if you want to become a successful exporter, we need to ensure that there is no custom detention of our exports. And for that, it is very important for us to have this session on how do you successfully reach your buyer without any custom detentions. And that is why we do this session on understanding the import regulatory norms across different export markets. Post-COVID, there will be a lot of export surplus. Everybody will want to sell. Therefore, we need to ensure how this particular compliance can become better competitive tool. You will not get to see your buyers anymore. So we need to work as compliance as a brand strategy for the companies. So from this perspective, we see compliance as a competitive tool, we see compliance as a brand tool, and we also understand the sources of information from where you get different sources of import regulatory norms across different markets. So friends, let's take the session forward. We talk about the session of managing global compliances in exports, where we talk about a different kinds of trade barriers that a company may face when they want to export their products to a new destination. Have you ever felt a situation where when you reach at the foreign port, your products look as nice as your other players' competitors, but the custom person says that I will not accept your product because they do not comply with my country's regulation? At this point of time, there is a huge anxiety to this company, and those anxiety is what we are trying to handle in this particular session. So we are technically handling three questions in this session. Number one, we talk about possible reasons why your exports can possibly get detained at the foreign port. Question number two, where do you find this information on import regulations across different countries? Question number three, how do you minimize this risk of export detention? One very interesting thing that apart from these three interesting and very important questions to reach your buyer without any hassle, the understanding on compliances is also giving you a very strategic tool. Now let's take an example. There were 25 countries which have restricted the Chinese dairy products when there was a melamine content that was found in the export of Chinese dairy commodities. Now you are a dairy company from India. How can you take advantage of this situation when Chinese were the biggest competitor for you? So advantage of getting compliance is you can take advantage of the fall of your competitor on certain quality issues. You can learn from the mistakes of other countries. For example, if you're aware about Chinese milk products getting detained in the Australian market because of some reason, or Pakistani or Vietnamese spice export getting detained in the European market for some reason, you learn from others' mistake. Use number three, you can use compliance as a brand strategy. After the COVID-19, most of the trade fairs will happen virtually. So you don't get to meet your buyers, you don't get to see them, you don't get to have an opportunity to technically enter into a negotiation with them. How do you reach them? How do you ensure that your social media presence is great? So compliances also help you write a beautiful brand story for your product. So let's talk about the four very important compliance that can help you answer these three questions and also help you work as a marketing and a brand tool. So these arena of global standards are technically on a quality front, on an environmental front, on a social front, and on a technology front. Let's talk about the first standard, which is the quality. Now this quality can be of two kinds. Quality ensured when you're exporting an agricultural product, quality assurance when you actually export a manufacturing product. You must have been aware about the quality issues the Indian agricultural exports have. For example, our Alfonso mangoes were banned in Europe. Our Thompson seedless grapes had faced detention because of certain presence of the chloride in the growth hormone in our grapes. And it was almost 70% of the grapes export were going to the European market. Can you imagine the amount of loss on the issues of quality front that may have? Our meat export were getting detained at the Australian port. After China, Vietnam is likely to ban the agri imports from India. So what does a person who wants to start a business of an agricultural product or a business of a processed food product should be doing at this time? Here comes the first kind of quality issues that comes to your rescue, known as the WTO sanitary and phytosanitary measure. Now this tool is very interesting because you have to ensure that which market that you're trying to export your product or agricultural product, how do you ensure that countries' consumers are being supplied the safe food to eat? This is a concern of an importing country. As an exporter, what's your concern? You have another concern that, oh my God, on the grounds of protecting the health standards of a country, US or Europe or Japan have raised the quality standards to a huge extent, and that acts as a barrier for me. It raises my cost of compliance. They're asking for many certificates. As a new company, as a startup, I technically find myself impossible to enter those barriers of compliances. Now, in order to maintain the balance between these two concerns of an importing country and the exporters, there is a WTO agreement on sanitary and phytosanitary measure. Now, how does this agreement help, and why should you be knowing about this agreement? Now, first thing first, when you want to export your product, friends, you need two concerns. You are an exporter from India. And your biggest competition coming, for example, you're an exporter of Alfonso mangoes from India. So your export competitiveness comes from Pakistan also selling Alfonso mangoes. Therefore, what this agreement actually talks about under the basic principle of WTO of most favored nation, if you are supplying Alfonso mangoes to the US and Pakistan is also supplying Alfonso mangoes to the US, as per the WTO agreement, it will ensure that the buyer sitting in the US or the customs of the US will have no discrimination between the SPS standard offered to the Pakistani Alfonso mango and offered to the Indian Alfonso mango. This concept is called as the MFN concept, which is a basic principle of WTO applicable on this particular agreement. The other concern that you might have, is there a difference in standard between the export of my product or the export of the local companies in the US? For example, if I'm a groundnut supplier to the US, maybe there are certain farmers and domestic companies of groundnut who are also doing this business in US. You are probably a competitor for them. So in order to protect the local companies supplying the same product that you would like to export to that country, there are many times the standards are different. So logically, under the National Treatment Clause of World Trade Organization, no country can have two different regulations. One for the products operating in the local market and the same product being imported. So if your products ever gets detained at the foreign port, always check what is the law applicable for the local companies under National Treatment Clause. You need to ensure that your detention is in sync with the detentions also done for the local companies, else you need to understand this basic difference of National Treatment Clause. Moving ahead, you are confused. There are so many countries in the world. Some countries you may have experience, but for other countries you may not have experience at all. So how do you ensure, where do you get this information about what is the standard of grapes in Australia? What is the standard of grapes in Japan? What is the standard of grapes in Europe? Are they same? So there are harmonization concept in the SPS agreement. So the WTO appreciates this concern of the companies. So on the quality compliance front, there are three bodies which are international bodies, and they have, to a certain extent, they have harmonized the global food standard. You should be aware about these three organizations. You can look into the food safety standards. through a body called as Codex Alimentarius. It is a body which is a joint initiative of Food and Agricultural Organization and World Health Organization. Codex standards are international standards and they are very safe to use. If you're looking for a product that is a meat product or an animal product, look for global standards which fall under World Organization for Animal Health, and it's the short form is OIE standards. The third is, if you're a exporter of a plant product, you have International Plant Protection Convention, which is an IPPC standard. So I repeat, this is a food safety standard, which is Codex. Then there is an animal health standard taken care by OIE as an organization. And you have International Plant Protection Convention, which talks about the plant health as a global standard. So these three organizations and the standards listed on their website comes to your rescue. Apart from that, you another data source where you can find the international quality standard for agricultural product is International Portal on Food Safety, Animal and Plant Health. The website address is given. And now comes a very interesting process. You get to know the standard. Suppose you have a particular standard of a fruit fly infestation of mangoes in Australia. There are local companies in Australia who also use the same standard. But there are different countries have different standards, and you obviously have to know and comply with that standard. But can Australians force the Indians that I use a particular process to reach that standard? And in order to export mangoes to Australia, even Indian mango companies should also follow the same process. In case there is an equivalence agreement signed between India and Australia, the Indians can use their own process to reach that standard, and Australians can use their own standard process to reach that standard. This concept is known as the equivalence concept. So before randomly accepting your buyer's request to follow the processes that they follow in their country, please check whether there is any equivalence agreement signed between you. Save a lot of money on venturing into the processes followed across different countries. Now there's another very interesting concept called regionalization in SPS. Whenever there is a quality concern, you must have heard about Nympha virus in Kerala bananas. You must have heard about bird flu strike that has happened in India. This was a case that has happened in the Northeast. So the concern is, whenever there is a disease outbreak in a country, it means that the entire country is not affected. There are certain pockets of the country that is affected. So in such a scenario, the concept of regionalization says that it is all about taking care of your product should not originate from that particular region which is impacted. If you are far away from the area where the disease has come, the importing country cannot detain your product. That's the concept of regionalization. But this concern is raised by an importing country. Suppose there is a fruit fly infestation or there is a bird flu infestation happening in Manipur area, your company is stated far off, say in Maharashtra, but you can always source your product from Manipur. So you're allowed to enter an European country from Maharashtra, but you have to ensure that I have not sourced this product from Manipur. And how do you do that is to the concept that Europe is very particular about, known as traceability. If you're an exporter of a final product, say a tomato juice, but you need to have a traceability certificate right from farm to fork in order to ensure that my sourcing of tomatoes have not come from the affected zone and I am completely off that track. So this concept is called traceability, which is actually a 10-digit code number which traces your product until their first source of raw material. Once you have tracked down the first source, and this is very important, if you visit the APIDA website, they've done a commendable job on establishing a traceability for horticulture products including mangoes. They're also working on pomegranates. Grapes is a very beautiful story. Groundnuts is what they have worked on. Organic products, meat product, basmati rice. So these are beautiful traceability systems that have already been in place. If you are a trader, it's better to purchase the products from the farmers or processors or middlemen who are registered in the traceability network. Therefore, you can ensure there is no export detention on the traceability front. After SPS, we come to the technical barriers to trade. Now, apart from agricultural product, you also export a manufacturing product. Even in the agricultural product, you have certain products like mycotoxins, pesticides, residues, which basically can have a drastic impact on your health. But there are certain products like labeling, like packaging, like certifications, like documentation. These are known as technical barriers to trade. So you should know what comes in technical barriers to trade. For example, let me give you certain examples. The country of origin was China. They were supplying these laser guns to Sweden and they got detained at the port because this particular product had a risk of damage to site. The other two examples are from the textile product, which were technically in the kids segment from Bangladesh and China, again to the European market. And the detention was all because there was no problem with the fabric, there was no problem on quality front, but the problem was on the taggles and the toggles that were used. There were these plastic toggles in the soft tie could be were removable, and it was actually causing the death fear in the kids in the country. So we have to be very cautious on the design that we're using. We have to be very cautious about the rejections on various fronts that can happen under technical barriers to trade. One of them can be packaging. So if you're using wood as a packaging material, it has a particular heat treatment because wood can carry fungus along. If you are using a packaging material, you can use that as a marketing tool. You will be surprised to note, friends, that a lot of economic incentives in the European market given to companies who are using recyclable packaging. And this is a great quality concern. If you're using the packaging material which are basically used recyclable and they're made out of a material that are not environmental hazard. Then we talk about the grading standards. In India, we have EGMARK standard, but it is still voluntary in nature. But if you want to become a successful exporter, follow the grading standards. So you have the US having the USDA having its own standard. In Japan, the Japan External Trade Organization and the JAS giving their own standards. European Union giving their own standards. So grading standards for agricultural product becomes very interesting. More than just the quality, it is also the product safety that becomes very important. So if you're an exporter of toys, if you're an exporter of electrical appliance, pressure vehicles, or you're an exporter of certain protective PPE kits for that matter, these days, CE marking is something mandatory, which actually confirms that you have conformed to the product European applicable safety and consumer protection standards in that market. If you're a supplier of gems and jewelry, you need to follow the REACH regulation. Anything related to chemical, because REACH is registration, evaluation, and authorization of certain chemicals. So anything related to chemical industry, or it is related to gems and jewelry where there's a nickel release. So depending on whether the gems is piercing into the skin, or you're using it as a purse, you're using it as an external thing, or in the watches, the standards across different countries and different countries of Europe depends on the REACH regulation. The TPT standards, next talk about the labeling laws. You'll be surprised, friends, every country has its own labeling laws. And where you can find them is, go to Google, just type GAIN report, which is Global Agri Information Network. Just type GAIN plus import standards plus the name of the country where you want to know the standard. You'll get all the packaging standards, labeling standards, the nutritional labeling, organic products, everything in the GAIN reports, which are very easily Googled. The third thing that we're talking about is all about the social standards. Have you heard about a fair trade certificate? Now you can see these fair trade shops in Southeast Asia. Now these certificates are very important, which says that it's a social standard, that people are very, very ethical in nature while buying. They see these tags. If you have a fair trade tags across your products, you need to be 3 years old to be eligible to get the standard. This is basically a standard that assures your buyers in the West that you have done an ethical treatment to your workers. Suppose you are a trader. You buy a product at 10,000 and you sell it at 2 lakhs. Are you being fair to the guy who has created it? So fair trade is basically ensuring that the guy who is actually a producer, maybe a farmer, or for an handicraft product, he may be an artisan. So he ensures that the producer receives the price that covers at least the average cost of their sustainable production. So we need to be very sure that it's good to earn margins, but it is also good to share the profit margins decently enough and not exploit the producers. That is what fair trade is. Trust me, friends, companies have used this as a marketing tool, and it's a one-time audit that you have, and it is applicable for 3 years. It is worth to spend on the social certification. The another certification which is also gaining importance in the global market is SA8000, which basically talks about the corporate social responsibility. How do you treat your workers? Are you discriminating on the basis of caste, creed, gender, religion? How is your basic facilities and amenities, I mean, are you exploiting your workers? So if you have a good working condition, there are basic auditing companies whom you can request. They can come and give you this SA8000. Write them on their website and you see how buyers get attracted to you. The third thing that we talk about is an environmental standard. You'll be surprised to know that trade and increased trade can actually contribute to environmental pollution. So the buyers in the West are very particular about concept of, in order to reach me from your factory to my factory, how much is the truck that has worked? How much is the ship that has worked? And the distance is the longer, the environmental is polluted longer. So they've started demanding certain foot mile certificate to ensure that have you used the shortest distance to reach me? Now these are newer standards that all of us should be aware of, which will actually have a marketing tool. If you write fair trade, if you write I'm SA compliance, I am food mile compliance, I'm also water footprint compliance. You'll be surprised, countries like Vietnam having a better edge. I mean, they are my competitors when it comes to rice farming. I mean, Taiwan is a competitor when it comes to leather. So certain countries, why they're attracting more buyers is all because in India, we use a lot of water in our tanning processes. So if we control that process, if we control and we are better cautious, we need to look forward for where the interest of the buyer is. So this is our environmental standards that are technically coming in the international market. I'm happy to share you an environmental branding story of a considered design of Nike. And you see for yourself that Nike introduced a new line of shoe where they made sure that the raw material that they purchased was within 200 miles. So they actually worked on foot miles. They changed their manufacturing processes so that they reduced their solvent use by 80%. They started taking leather from the tanneries which recycled the wastewater. They completely changed the design of the product so that the usage of the toxic adhesives were minimized. Now this is the story that helped them sell in the market, and this is where compliance talks about. The last thing that we talk about is a technology compliance. Now after COVID-19, everything will be online. The companies will be bound to use computers. So we need to talk about something very important in the market called as Unfair Competition Act, which will not allow you to use any kind of pirated softwares, because there are a lot of companies who are manufacturing that CAD, CAM, and they're investing hugely on these softwares. And if the users globally start using pirated software versions, it's actually a non-compliant behavior. So under the pressures of these companies, there is a law that has passed on that if you are an exporter and you're selling a product using a pirated software to a company sitting in US, the company sitting in US cannot buy anything as a law from any exporter that is not technology compliance. Now this law is in US, but it has a global impact. Suppose that you are exporting your product to the Japanese buyer, and Japanese buyer is buying a product to finally sell it to the US market. So when the global supply chain is a part of, it is the Japanese buyer's responsibility to ensure that if he is buying a raw material from an Indian company, finally making a value-added product to supply to the US market, it becomes the responsibility of the Japanese company to declare that the entire value chain at a back end is technology compliant. So the law is of the US, but somewhere it actually have an impact globally. So we talk about the technology compliance, and we have to be very cautious, guys, because if you see the global piracy rates in 2019-2020, India is just at the fourth position.
We are better off than Russians, we are better off than Chinese, but we also have to make sure that many countries are far, far, better than us in terms of small countries like Vietnam, Mexico, Brazil, Colombia. In many product categories, they are my competitors. So if I become technology compliant, I stand a better chance to get hold of these markets. And finally, not the least, we need to understand IPR compliances, which is your intellectual property rights compliance, which talks about how do you protect copyrights. You need to know trademarks, you need to know how to work on patents, industrial design. You should not be copying anything from the internet because now everything will be sold online. So it's easy to catch hold of these IPR. So protect, create your own designs, but also give it a legal compliance in terms of getting it copyrighted, getting it a trademark protection, use geographical indications as a marketing tool. That finishes you a lot of compliance story. Apart from the other websites, the information where you can collect, I'm sharing with you two interesting websites. You get to see a body which is a Ministry of Foreign Affairs body in Netherlands called CBI, and it gives you a beautiful market information, how to enter the European market, what are the buyer's norms, what are the buyer's requirement, both legal, non-legal, 26 markets of Europe behaving in 26 different ways across different product categories. And you also have sustainablemap.org, which is giving you across different product categories, across many, many countries, 200 countries in the world, 6,000 product categories. Look into these websites, plan your export very methodically because everything taken care of, if non-tariff barriers and import regulations, compliances are not taken care of, it becomes very difficult for us to cross the customs and the entire opportunity to export is lost. So friends, I hope you enjoyed this session. This session practically speaks about helping you to minimize your export rejections possibility. Your entire exercise of finding a buyer in the international market, taking these schemes like Market Development Assistance Scheme and MAI through your export promotion councils to participate in the trade fair, in the virtual trade fairs, the entire exercise will go down the drain. Until the time we actually are aware about the import regulatory norms across different markets. So in this session, we very methodically close the final loop of entering into a final country destination without having the risk of getting detained at the port. So I repeat, we did quality compliance, we did social compliance, we did environmental compliance, and we did technology compliance. We also worked on a lot of data sources from where you can find out internet resource on different countries' regulation across different markets. We saw global trade databases, we saw standards map, we saw sustainability map, we saw CBI.eu, and we saw a lot of WTO database from where you get an information about import regulatory norm. I'm sure with this particular session, you are now confident enough to reach your buyer without having any risk of having any kind of export retentions. All the best.